Am I audible?
Yes.
Hello?
Yeah, well audible and screen is also visible.
Shall I start, sir?
Yeah, sure, please start.
So, good evening, everyone. Today we'll be discussing neonatal AKI. So, I'll be covering this topic under the following headings: the definition, the incidence, the etiology, risk factors, management, outcome of AKI, and long-term follow-up. So coming on to the definition, so AKI in any age group is basically an acute decline in GFR leading to retention of urea and other nitrogenous products, and also loss of regulation of fluid, electrolyte, and acid base. But the special challenges in newborns being that right after birth, the serum creatinine that we get in newborns is a reflection of the maternal creatinine. And then it declines at various rates over days to weeks, depending on the gestational age. Then in preterm infants, they may have a creatinine level higher than their mothers. So when we'll be expecting a decline in creatinine, it might actually increase because their underlying creatinine is higher. This is basically due to the increased resorption of creatinine in the tubules and decrease in the total body fluid that is there in preterm newborns. Thus, the natural physiology and immature handling of creatinine by newborn kidney renders changes in serum creatinine, which are difficult to interpret when assessing for AKI. AKI traditionally has been defined as either an increase in creatinine or a decrease in urine output. Currently, the focus is on biomarkers. Basically, creatinine takes a lot of time to rise, even much before the injury might have started. So they want to now focus on early detection of AKI. So there are so biomarkers can be of two types. They can be functional biomarkers and they can be structural biomarkers. So creatinine, cystatin C, they are basically functional biomarkers. There are certain structural biomarkers are also available, which might help in assessing the structural damage. Anyway, as of now, serum creatinine and urine output are the main tools which help us identify and classify AKI. So these are the two classifications being compared, the Rifle and the Akin criteria. So one basically defines risk injury failure on the basis of the percentage rise in creatinine. And the other says a 1.5 fold or a 2 fold rise. The urine output criteria is almost similar for both. So there was a lot of discussion whether these criteria, which are basically, these are basically extrapolation from the adult guidelines. So there was a lot of discussion whether these can be used in newborns, whether there should be different cutoffs for newborns. There was a lot of discussion. So this one is a landmark trial known as the AWAKEN trial. So in this, basically what they did, they studied neonates. So they basically hypothesized that different gestational age groups require different creatinine thresholds. And they basically included neonates with serum creatinine more than 1 on postnatal age day 1 and 2. And again, serum creatinine more than equal to 1 on postnatal age day 3 and day 4. And they compared the mortality of rise in creatinine by 0.3 versus percentage rise of more than 50%. And they also compared if combining both the two, both these criteria is of any help. So they found that the 0.3 rise outperformed the more than 50% rise criteria. And they also found that percentage rise did not improve the mortality predictability. So looking for both in a newborn did not improve the mortality predictability. So it was concluded that unique serum creatinine rise cutoffs for different age groups should be there. So to avoid the confusion, this is the classification being followed right now, available in all standard textbooks. Then there was these Bruhl and colleagues, they reported a critical serum creatinine value based on gestational age. So a lot of situations where we may not have a baseline creatinine to compare to. So they said that at these particular gestational ages, an absolute value can be taken, and they found that the risk of mortality and worse neurodevelopmental outcomes are 2 years of age with these creatinine. So they took 1.6 for newborns between 24 to 27 weeks of gestation, 1.2 between 28 to 29 weeks of gestation, and 1 for newborns between 30 to 32 weeks of gestation. Coming on to the incidence, the reported incidence of AKI in neonatal ICUs varies widely depending on the patient sample and AKI definition. The more important thing is to recognize the at-risk newborns. So newborns with perinatal hypoxia, premature and low birth weight infants, infants with congenital heart disease, especially those requiring cardiopulmonary bypass, infants on ECMO, sick infants, infants with sepsis, with congenital anomalies of the kidney and urinary tract. These are the ones at risk for AKI. Then coming on to etiology, we are all aware of the pre-renal, renal, and post-renal etiological factors. So pre-renal will be where there's excessive loss of volume, that is in hemorrhage or dehydration, where there is excessive capillary leak, like in sepsis, shock, NEC, RDS, hypoalbuminemia, then decreased renal perfusion, such as in congestive heart failure. Certain drugs which cause vasoconstriction can also cause. Then coming to the intrinsic renal parenchymal, sustained hypoperfusion leading to ATN will, a pre-renal insult will be converted to a renal insult. Then congenital anomalies such as agenesis, hypoplasia, dysplasia, polycystic kidney disease, thromboembolic diseases. Then certain nephrotoxic drugs like aminoglycosides, radiocontrast agents, maternal use of captopril and indomethacin. Then certain infections like syphilis, toxoplasma, pyelonephritis. Then postnatal factors can be urethral obstruction, PUV, uretrocele, uretropelvic or uretrovesical obstruction, extrinsic tumors, neurogenic bladder, megacystis, megaureter syndrome. So all these are the etiological factors. Then this is the most important part of the topic, and I would like to emphasize that primary prevention of AKI is very important. So identifying the risk factors and identifying the at-risk babies is the most important and is being emphasized thoroughly in pediatric nephrology community. So we should be aware of the maternal risk factors, the neonatal risk factors, and as well as the high-risk procedures where babies will be more prone to develop AKI. So maternal high-risk factors like socioeconomic factors, then maternal nutrition, alcohol consumption, smoking, hypertensive disorders in the mother, medication use, oligohydroamnios, then chorioamnionitis, perinatal asphyxia, then high-risk neonates, especially preterms, low birth weight babies with congenital anomaly of the kidney and urinary tract, congenital heart disease babies, ECMO, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy babies, babies with high risk for dehydration. Then babies with high risk procedures like going on to cardiopulmonary bypass during surgeries, complex heart diseases, then undergoing radio contrast, receiving iodinated contrast for investigation purposes, then major surgical procedures, then high risk states, dehydration, then enterocolitis. Yeah. So basically all these, again, identification of high risk newborns is very important to, early treatment and early initiation of treatment in AKI has the best outcomes. If you identify AKI and treat it timely, that will have the best mortality and morbidity benefits. Delaying the treatment is the worst thing that we can do. So identification of the high-risk neonates is a very important part of managing neonatal AKIs. Now, coming on to a neonate who has already developed or is suspected to have AKI. So, like approach to any neonate, history and examination and assessment of the fluid status is very important. So on history, we would like to find out if any prenatal ultrasounds have been done. If the baby is receiving any new nephrotoxic drugs, any maternal exposure to ACE or ARBs, perinatal asphyxia, prematurity, excessive fluid losses like diarrhea, then any family history of congenital nephrotic syndrome, cystic kidney diseases, oligohydramnios. So basically these on history. Then on examination, very important to assess the weight of the baby. So daily weight, in fact, twice a day if possible, weight assessment is very important. It helps us in finding out whether the baby is euvolemic, hypovolemic, or hypervolemic. That is the best way to find out the hydration status of the baby. Then assessing the vitals, tachycardia would generally suggest a hypovolemic baby. Hypertension would generally suggest a hypervolemic baby. Then assessing for palpable kidneys. If the kidneys are palpable, we can get some hint that probably it could be renal vein thrombosis or hydronephrosis or cystic kidney disease. Palpable bladder would tell us that there is some obstructive cause to the AKI. Then looking for congenital anomalies like ambiguous genitalia, undescended testis, ear abnormalities would again tell us the same things. Though blood test and urine test have been mentioned here, but the blood tests have some limitations because the basically very preterm newborns will be proteinuric, will have some amount of glycosuria. And if it is a catheterized sample, some amount of microscopic hematuria is also normal for such babies. Yes, muddy brown granular casts found on urine examination is definitely, if the lab is able to report, it is definitely suggestive of ATN. Then very frequently done urine osmolality, sodium, they have very limited importance, especially in preterm newborns. Because as we know that in preterm newborns, they have a very poor urine concentrating ability. So the fractional excretion of sodium is much higher in them. So the fractional excretion of sodium, the FeNA that we calculate, the urinary sodium and urine osmolality that we calculate to differentiate between pre-renal and post-renal, that is of limited importance. Like, we cannot give a lot of importance to those. Then we have to know that very preterm newborns, the fractional excretion of sodium can be as high as 6%. The usual cutoff that we take for older children and adults is 1%. In newborns, in very preterms, the ones below maybe 30 weeks can have a fractional excretion of 6%, and even then they will be pre-renal. So assessing the sodium is very important. Sodium will help us. Usually a high sodium would tell us increased amount of free water losses and dehydration for the baby. A low sodium would generally tell us a fluid overload state in newborns. Radiological evaluation has a lot of importance. It would tell us about any obstructive features, then basically these. Then management, again, maintenance of a fluid and electrolyte balance is very important. Adequate nutrition is very important. So nutrition in newborns with AKI, we would want them to have a calorie intake of around 100 calories, kilocalories per day. And babies for whom we are able to get breast milk, that is the best. If we are suggesting for formula milk, there are some special formula known as Similac PM6040, which is a low solute formula that is available. That can be used. Then this human milk fortifier should be avoided because they have a high phosphate load. Amino acid, if the baby is on TPN, one should avoid too much protein. So maximum 1.5 grams per kg should be all right. But babies on dialysis, we would want to give some extra. So maybe 3 grams per kg should be fine. Then coming on to pre-renal. So boluses, yes, definitely. Fluid challenge is definitely one thing that is used. So a baby who is not grossly volume overloaded or in CHF, one can definitely try a 10 ml per kg bolus, aiming for a urine output of 1 ml per kg. And Lasix challenge also, yes, if hemodynamically stable, not septic baby, we can try. And Lasix infusion is considered better than bolus doses because it has been seen to decrease the amount of drug that is used and administered, and also to get a sustained response. Then Lasix should be avoided if it is not able to produce any response. Continuing Lasix even in the absence of urine output would only lead to nephrotoxicity, nothing else. Then definitely eliminating any drug-induced this thing should be avoided. So if we are aware of any drugs, nephrotoxic drugs, that should definitely be eliminated. And if the cause is known, then cause should be treated. So management is supportive management and definitive management of the underlying cause. So again, to re-emphasize, supportive management is very important. And supportive management would include monitoring of the volume intake output daily basis. Keeping a track of the cumulative fluid overload is also very important. If we can calculate the everyday balance and make a cumulative chart, that would help us a lot in knowing how much we have to target, how much ultrafiltrate or whatever we need to remove. Then evaluation for any potential nephrotoxic medications should be done. Then nutrition I have already spoken about. So this again emphasizes the role of fluid challenge and how it should be done. Then coming on to renal replacement therapies. So if medically with the supportive care, we are not able to manage, then early initiation of renal replacement therapy is indicated. So persistent hyperkalemia, hyponatremia, acidosis, uremic symptoms, we should consider renal replacement therapies. The three modalities that we can use in neonates is peritoneal dialysis, the most commonly done in most centers, then CRRT and hemodialysis. So I'm sorry, this slide I think is not very well visible, but PD is generally preferred in most centers because it is easy to perform. If you're able to put in a CAPD catheter, we can teach the parents to do it, how to do it at home. If chronic dialysis is needed, then dietary restrictions are fewer, no vascular access issues, heparin administration, systemic heparin administration is not an issue there. The problems is that sometimes we are not able to, the abdominal cavity may be compromised, some intra-abdominal surgeries might have been done, or there's a congenital diaphragmatic hernia. In those cases, we are not able to use it. Then there can be complications. Hemodialysis, it is very efficient in clearance and ultrafiltration, but we cannot use it for hemodynamically unstable babies, and there are access related issues. Then we have to heparinize the circuit, so that is an issue. Then if the extracorporeal, that is the tubings and the dialyzer and all those, if the volume of those is more than the 10% volume of the patient blood volume, then we need to do something known as blood priming. Then there also intradialytic hypotension, catheter thrombosis, DDS, then line infections, and all those are possible. PRRT can also be, few advanced centers are even doing newborn CRRTs. The good thing about it is that it can be done in hemodynamically unstable patients, and the ECMO circuit, the same circuit, can be used for CRRT also. And then again, blood priming will be required if the circuit volume is more than 10% of the blood volume of the baby. Vascular access related issues are there in newborns, and line infections and malfunctions, those are issues. So again, this is a very important slide. Some Brenner's hypothesis. So any baby who has an AKI, or premature babies, low birth weight babies, there is some injury to the nephrons and would lead to a reduction in the number of nephrons. And the body would compensate by the leftover nephrons will work extra hard to compensate for the ones that are not there. And this would lead to something known as a hyperfiltration injury and glomerular hypertension, which would ultimately lead to systemic hypertension and proteinuria. And these babies are at risk for CKD. So all AKI babies, all babies who have AKI once, they are at risk for CKD. So follow-up is very, very important. All premature babies, babies with a history of AKI, IUGR, structural anomalies, they should have a regular follow-up. And on follow-up, if they are found to have a sustained BP elevation of more than 95th centile, proteinuria, elevated creatinine, or abnormal ultrasound, they should be referred to a pediatric nephrologist for further management. So the take-home messages from this presentation. AKI is very common in neonatal intensive care units, and it seems to affect the patient outcome. And AKI is a heterogeneous disorder with many mechanisms and management strategies. Current AKI biomarkers are limited and often late indicators that that injury has occurred. Development of new precise biomarkers is a major focus of current research. Care of neonate with AKI is primarily supportive. Maintenance of adequate renal perfusion, prevention of fluid overload, avoidance of nephrotoxic medications, and consideration of early initiation of renal supportive or renal replacement therapy should improve outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Samriddhi. It was a very crisp presentation. And I believe being a topic, neonatal AKI is not an easy topic. I am sure many questions are there. So I would request all the participants, those who have any questions, to please come out with your questions, or you can type over here and we will talk about those questions in detail. I have received one question which says how to choose the right fluid for a child who is diagnosed with hydronephrosis, bilateral hydronephrosis with due to secondary PVL, urethral valves. So how to choose the right fluid for such a newborn, age 2 days, and his child is on ventilator. So how do we select what kind of fluid and how do we calculate it once?
So firstly, I am presuming that the obstruction, the relieving of obstruction part has been taken care of. So I think what you're trying to ask is that after relieving the obstruction, when massive diuresis start post release of obstruction, there's usually a lot of urine output that is produced and diuresis that happens. So I think what you're trying to ask is how to replace the amount of excessive loss of urine and how to replace the urine output. So usually we can start by N by 2. We can use N by 2 for replacing urine outputs. The better thing that can be done is you can check the urinary sodium, and whatever urinary sodium comes, that amount of that, the same kind of fluid you can use.
So we have to see the urine sodium content and we decide as per the electrolyte losses, we have to decide the right fluid.
That's right.
Okay. Other question is how to approach a newborn with absent one kidney?
How to assess a newborn with absent right kidney?
The kidney if absent.
Okay. So, firstly, we have to see whether the one kidney that is there, that is working or not. So baseline investigations like a serum creatinine and a urine. So if it is a child with a solitary kidney, that one kidney is very important. So assessing for its function, then later on, if right now that kidney is not obstructed, not causing any, not having any infection, no VUR, then we can just follow up with ultrasounds. And then later on, once the baby is at least 6 weeks old, we can go for a DMSA scan to see if there is any ectopic kidney that we are missing or any such thing. If the function of the working kidney, all those can be seen on a DMSA scan. Again, the basic things are very important. That is measuring the serum creatinine levels, blood pressure levels, not missing any infection. So in a simple CUE, all these are very important.
There is one more question in the group. If it says by Dr. Lokesh Pandey, if urine output is normal, in spite of that, what are the indications of monitoring for AKI, fluid management in polyuria, where urine output is approximately 10 ml per kg per hour in preterm babies? These are the two questions. If you can go to the chat box, Dr. Samriddhi, there are two questions. If I'm not able to tell you correctly, can you please read them?
If the urine output is normal, in spite of that, what are the indications of monitoring for AKI? So AKI can always be oliguric AKI or non-oliguric AKI. Mostly the drug-induced AKIs are generally non-oliguric AKIs. Unless a very serious insult has happened, renal insult has happened, they can initially be non-oliguric. Even an oliguric AKI with the use of diuretics can sometimes be converted from an oliguric to a non-oliguric AKI. Monitoring in both the cases is definitely very important because a non-oliguric AKI can anytime progress into an oliguric AKI. Then coming on to fluid management in polyuria. So urine output is more than 10 ml per kg per hour in a preterm. So preterms, as I said during the presentation also, that preterms, they have a very poor urinary concentrating ability. So even in the presence of dehydration, they will not be able to concentrate their urine so much. So they are generally more prone to polyuria. Then working up for polyuria is definitely very important. Work up what is the cause for polyuria. But in acute setting, replace the urine output basically. So replacing anything that is above 5 ml per kg per hour. If you replace the whole thing, then you will just be chasing the urine output. You will give, they will produce more. So this cycle will go on. So basically, you should aim for replacing urine output, anything more than 4 to 5 ml per kg.
And we should choose this replacement fluid as per the urine sodium content?
We can do that. To start with, we can start by N by 2. And once we get the urinary sodium report based on.
Generally, which type of fluid is used when you are treating such patients? What kind of fluid is generally?
It usually comes out to N by 2 only. Okay. From the centers from where I have worked, usually we were using N by 2. Even when we assessed the urinary sodium, the fluid that came out to be was usually somewhere around N by 2. Next question is from Veronica. What is the emergency management steps in a newborn with severe perinatal hypoxia and baby not making urine? So perinatal hypoxia is definitely a different topic which should be discussed in a lot of detail. Then baby not making urine is basically you first need to assess what is the urine output and assess the volume status. So basically the whole presentation, you have to assess the volume status of the baby. See if if the baby is already not fluid overloaded, you can consider a bolus. Then see if there are signs of sepsis, preed sepsis. Then so basically the whole thing you have to evaluate, what is the cause, why the baby is not making urine. So emergency management, if you are asking, then maybe yes, we can assess the volume status of baby. If you don't feel that the baby has a congestive heart failure or is grossly volume overloaded, you can consider one bolus. If the tachycardia and there is clinical improvement, you can consider one more bolus. Then based on the blood pressures and the hemodynamics of the baby, you can consider Lasix challenge also. And then you have to go on assessment. The next question is, comments on challenges in classification of neonatal AKI according to Rifle versus KEDIGO criteria. So all these Rifle criteria, KEDIGO criteria, they were all initially proposed by adults and they were later on modified for the pediatric and neonatal age group. So there is a lot of discussion going on whether these can be simply extrapolated to newborns or not, as I had discussed in a lot of detail in my presentation also. I had discussed about the AWAKEN trial, where they are saying that an increase in serum creatinine of more than 0.3 from the baseline definitely found to have a higher risk for morbidity and mortality. Then the next question is, any role of Lasix challenge in oliguric or enuric post bolus? So Lasix challenge, you have to see clinically. If a baby is grossly septic and is in septic shock, you will not want to give a diuretic. But if the patient you feel is volume replete, yes, you can definitely try a Lasix challenge. And if the baby is able to produce a urine output of more than 1 ml per kg post the Lasix challenge, there is definitely an indication for Lasix infusion. But if there is no output with the Lasix challenge, and then there is no point giving more and more Lasix, because it would only, Lasix is also nephrotoxic and ototoxic, as we all know. So it would only increase the amount of toxicity if it is not able to produce. So dose can be 1 to 3 mg per kg bolus. I think those are all the questions.
So Dr. Samriddhi, if we are giving Lasix and we know the dose, so before we go to Lasix, what I understand is, if child is having a pre-renal status and we have to challenge with fluid, and if child is already puffed up because of fluid, we can give a Lasix 1 to 3 mg per kg. Look out for urine output. If urine is not being produced, don't overgo, because Lasix also is a toxic drug and it has ototoxicity as well. Are there any specific recommendation where we should give a trial of another diuretic, metalazone or something in neonates also?
Not you, sir. Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. So I believe if all the questions have been answered, still in case if somebody is having some questions, feel free to put them and I'll take them with the ma'am. Great. Thank you, Dr. Samriddhi, for sharing your knowledge and teaching us. It was an incredible session.
My pleasure.
We can do much more sessions like this and learn more from you. Thanks a lot. Thank you, everyone, for joining. Take care.